because it hurts becoming this.
The Secrets She Keeps. Press red for all episodes on BBC iPlayer.
Temperatures are rising in the All That Glitters workroom.
There's a different timer.
Well, you're freaking me out.
I need a stiff drink now.
The chaos ordering gods.
What is that?
All That Glitters continues Thursday at 9 on BBC Two and iPlayer.
The greatest classical music festival. Curated by us, enjoyed by you. There's nothing quite like the BBC Proms. For exclusive coverage, watch on iPlayer, listen on Sounds.
Ain't just about cricket.
I wish I could just fly.
It's about smashing some serious sixes.
Sixes galore. Everyone's loving it.
Live from Lords.
What more do you want?
The women's final, followed by the men's final. The 100, live tomorrow from 2:30 on BBC Two and iPlayer.
This is what happens when we go shopping together. Oh, it's fine, just whatever. It's just a chicken.
How do they taste different?
They taste more chicken-y.
Well, they're chickens. All right.
An argument about a chicken. You're coming like those terrible old people.
Oh, I've been one of them for years.
Marriage. Press red to watch on BBC iPlayer.
Is under attack by a suspected foreign power. Do you know what the government's response is? And neither do I.
They're into our secure comms.
Kilo 9, this is control. Do you read?
All units, shots fired.
The Capture continues Sunday at 9 on BBC One and iPlayer.
Welcome to Friday morning on BBC One with Breakfast.
Good morning. Welcome to Breakfast with Charlie State and Nagat Manchetti.
Celebrating the life and legacy of our friend and colleague Bill Turnbull after his death at the age of 66.
Hello, this is Breakfast with Sean Williams and Bill Turnbull.
Bill became one of the nation's most loved broadcasters, presenting Breakfast for 15 years. We'll speak to his former sofa partners later on the show.
We'll hear how Bill's prostate cancer campaigning saved lives and encouraged thousands of men to come forward for testing.
We'll also hear about his real passions, like his football team, Wycombe Wanderers. I'm here at their ground this morning, which was like a second home from home for two decades. I'll be speaking to a player, the manager and the staff who loved Bill so much and knew him so well.
And in other news, good morning from Blackpool, which will be lit up with illuminations tonight. But with the country facing an energy crisis, I've been finding out how the town is keeping the lights on.
Plus in weather, while some of you will stay dry with some sunshine at times through this weekend, there is a greater chance we're going to see some rain, heavy and thundery, especially in the west. I'll have all the details here on Breakfast.
Good morning. It's Friday, the 2nd of September. Tributes have been coming in for our friend and colleague, Bill Turnbull, who's died at the age of 66.
Bill presented here on Breakfast for 15 years. It was in 2017 when he revealed he'd been diagnosed with advanced prostate cancer and he went on to encourage other men to get themselves checked out.
Bill's being remembered by those who knew him as a wonderful friend, great fun and an incredible talent. Graham Satchell has more.
Oh, no, time code. Phil.
Bill Turnbull and Sean Williams with less than a minute to go before the start of another programme.
Thank you.
Oh, 15?
Bill checking everything to make sure it's perfect.
He was just great to work with. You know, you don't get up at 3:30 in the morning for 11 years to sit next to somebody you don't like, and we got on really, really well.
Hello, this is Breakfast with Sean Williams and Bill Turnbull.
The St Paul's protesters... You know, it felt like a family. It felt like a family on set. And the Breakfast viewers felt like family to us.
Hello,
good morning. This is Breakfast
with Louise Minchin
and Sean Williams.
Over the years, Bill had 14 so-called TV wives. All of them say the same things. First, that Bill was funny, always funny.
Friday, the 27th of April.
He had a really mischievous sense of humour.
It's a sign of your immense importance that you have so many people from the studio.
Man, immense. I don't even know what that word meant.
You need Bill as part of your entourage.
I'm not saying words like that. He ain't gonna confuse me all day.
I'll be your vocabularist.
Yeah.
Some little quirk would happen, and you'd see Bill start to laugh.
That's another one. He two for two. Vocabularist.
Yeah.
What is that? Yeah. I've never heard that mistake.
Walking thesaurus.
Oh my God, he's on fire! Bill's on fire, man.
And you knew that as soon as Bill started to laugh, you were not going to be able to hold it together.
Oh, look, he put "is." He just put "is" on the back of everything.
Exactly.
You've cracked the secret.
I got nothing. I thought I had something.
You're the best guestist we've had.
The guestist. Oh!
And some of my fondest moments of working with Bill were just giggling uncontrollably. You would tell really bad jokes, and some very naughty ones as well. But that was part of his charm.
Well, I was taking great interest in your isobars there. Would you say they were tightly packed?
They are quite tightly packed, yeah, yes. I love Billy, always will, and just adored working with him. When I saw he was on in the morning, my day was already complete before we'd even started. And I'm going to miss him terribly. What a loss. What an absolute loss.
He was a brilliant, talented, insightful, sharp-eyed journalist, but at the heart of him was this really amusing, funny person that I absolutely adored working with.
We're meant to be hearing the sound of this.
We're hearing the sound of mosquitoes, but they've decided they're going to stay in bed this morning.
I mean, the day I let the mosquitoes out, for example, I mean, what were we doing even having mosquitoes on the sofa? He let himself be bitten by the mosquitoes.
Also, you have to be careful when you're trying to swat a mosquito because you can do yourself quite a lot of harm, can't you, please?
Thanks, Phil.
So there you are, you know, somebody who's interviewed Prime Minister, letting himself be bitten live on national television by mosquitoes. He enjoyed the versatility of being able to do everything that you threw at him.
He loved the dressing up for Children in Leaves. He loved doing Strictly. All the spangles and the fake tan, and we used to joke about it, but he just loved that. We had a lot of laughs, and I'm really going to miss that.
George Bush is walking an environmental tightrope.
Bill had a long career as a foreign correspondent. By the time he came to Breakfast TV, he was hugely experienced and extremely rigorous. He expected high standards from everyone.
He was an absolute stickler for accuracy, both in grammar and in spelling as well. And I think he called it grammar hammer.
It's to try to, not to try and.
For example, on the banned list are legendary, iconic, unique, for example.
Don't use the word iconic connected to anything. That's a cliche.
He mentored everybody on the programme. He was like the father of BBC Breakfast.
And I am definitely a better journalist because I sat next to him with that rigour for hours and hours.
He taught me everything. He taught so many of us everything about journalism and about television and about being a decent person in this industry. He was kind and compassionate and wise and a great friend, and I loved every minute of being with him, and we're really going to miss him.
When Bill was diagnosed with prostate cancer in 2018, it was a devastating blow. He was an intensely private man, but spoke out publicly, urging other men to get themselves checked.
I don't think there are many people in this world who can change lives, save lives by what they say. And he did that, and I think that is an incredible legacy. And I know there'll be people, you know, who'll be waking up tomorrow morning safe and well because of him, and that's an incredibly generous thing to have done.
Come on.
Saving other men's lives was a remarkable final act for a good man who lived an extraordinary life.
I'll remember 30 years of friendship and support and laughter. What you saw on the telly was how he was, kind, gentle, funny, clever. Just a lovely bloke, really. And I'll miss him.
Well, as you heard in that report, in the years after his diagnosis, Bill raised awareness of prostate cancer and the warning signs to look out for after he admitted waiting too long to see his GP.
It is the most common cancer in men, with 1 in 8 being diagnosed in their lives. Our medical editor, Fergus Walsh, has more.
Every week, around 1,000 men in the UK are told they have prostate cancer. Bill Turnbull was diagnosed in late 2017. Like many men, he'd put off getting symptoms checked out.
I prided myself on the fact that I had not been to see my GP for 4 years. I was not aware that something, in fact, was going rather wrong inside me. I was getting pains in my legs and my hips particularly, and they would come and go, and I thought, this is old age.
Finally, he went for a checkup.
He said, well, I'm just going to give you a blood test, just a sort of MOT, if you like, just to check a few things out. The next morning, he called me and asked me to come in pretty quickly. And the doctor said, it's fairly clear from this that you have advanced prostate cancer and that it has spread to the bone. I thought, now I've got to deal with the future, or having much less of a future than I thought I had.
In the place set.
Bill revealed his diagnosis in a celebrity edition of the Great British Bake Off in aid of the charity Stand Up to Cancer, explaining why you shouldn't delay getting symptoms checked out.
If I'd had a test a few years ago, we would have diagnosed it earlier and knocked it on the head earlier. My survival possibilities would be a lot better.
His openness about his cancer had an immediate and significant effect. Cancer charities say it will have saved many lives.
Bill has made a profound impact on raising awareness of prostate cancer. When he so openly and candidly talked about his diagnosis in 2018, the following year we saw an increase in 20% of referrals into the NHS. And our own helpline, in fact, had 200% increase in people making calls. So he has worked with us to campaign tirelessly to make sure that men understand about their risk of prostate cancer and what they can do about it. He has literally helped save thousands of lives.
The actor and writer Stephen Fry revealed his prostate cancer diagnosis around the same time. His was caught early.
Cancer, I've got cancer. I went around.
The Turnbull and Fry effect led to many men getting their cancer diagnosed sooner.
Hello. Lisa.
Hi, Bill.
Hi, how are you? Nice to meet
Lovely
you.
Lovely to meet
you.
All right. Yes,
Carl.
Very good.
Carl Skinner went for tests as a result of seeing Bill on TV. His prostate cancer was caught before it was too late, and he responded well to treatment. Carl and his daughter Lisa met Bill in person in 2018.
I think we just feel hugely indebted to you, so.
I don't think you should, but thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks very much. It was just something I thought was the right thing to do at the time.
It's very heartwarming when people get in touch and I think, well, I have done at least one useful thing in my life.
Every year, around 52,000 men in the UK will be diagnosed with cancer of the prostate, a walnut-sized gland at the base of the bladder. More than three quarters will survive at least a decade, but the trouble is too many men are being diagnosed once their cancer has spread. Prostate cancer mainly affects men over 50. A family history of the disease is another risk factor, and there's a much higher incidence among black men. Early prostate cancer doesn't usually have symptoms, but problems with peeing, needing to go more often, difficulty starting or stopping can be a sign. Pain in the back or hips or blood in the urine or semen are other warning signs. There's no single test for prostate cancer. Physical exams, scans and biopsies are all used. You may be offered a blood test. High levels of the protein PSA can indicate cancer, but it's not always reliable. In 2019, I reported from University College Hospital in London about a trial examining whether an MRI scan and PSA blood test could be used to diagnose those prostate cancers which are growing aggressively and need urgent treatment, as opposed to those which may never cause problems. If successful, within 5 years, it could lead to a screening program, a bit like those for breast and cervical cancer. Bill Turnbull's death will undoubtedly lead to another surge in men seeking answers for nagging symptoms, which they may have put off getting checked for months or even years. And it will hopefully save many more lives. Fergus Walsh, BBC News.
Well, I'm delighted to say that quite a few people you've seen in some of those films are joining us live this morning, including that family that you saw Bill meeting, for whom he was so important, because him being so public about his diagnosis meant that lots of people just came forward who wouldn't have done otherwise, which is amazing in itself.
So you saw Carl and Lisa there, and they're going to be joining us a little bit later on. Let's take a look at some of the morning papers, and not surprisingly, many paying tribute to Bill. The Metro's headline reading: simply, thank you, Bill. In reference to what we've just been seeing, the thousands of lives he's said to have saved by being so open about his prostate cancer and urging men to get tested.
Daily Mail has a picture of Bill and Carol dancing together after Carol announced she would be taking part in Strictly Come Dancing. Bill, you'll probably remember, came sixth on the show in one of the early seasons. That was back in 2005. We will be talking to his then dance partner, Karen, a little later on in the programme this morning.
The Express features Bill and his wife, Ceci. Paying tribute to her husband, she said, "Lovely Billy made us laugh every day." We're also going to be joined, as Charlie said, by Bill's Strictly partner, Karen Hardy, who's described Bill as a gentleman and a mentor.
Let's take a look back at some of their moments together on the programme.
He loved it, didn't he? He absolutely loved it.
He did. And we will be chatting more about that later on. Does make you smile watching that stuff.
Always,
it really does.
Always. Let's talk to Matt, find out about the weather. Hey, Matt, how are you doing? I mean, it's a day of reflection, isn't it, on a fabulous man?
It is, yeah, but full of smiles as well, I think, as you saw from that. I started to work with him about 18 years ago, and The big thing, I think, as everybody said, it was just how warm and friendly he was when you met him for the first time on there on set. Put you at ease straight away. And that air of authority with that little cheekiness he had is a special, special mix. And I don't think you can be part of someone's breakfast routine for 15 years without that as well. And the interactions between him and the directors off air were something else. They were brilliant.
They're something. But that's for another. That's kind of video that we'll be playing internally, I think. I don't think we could put that on air.
Exactly. And I will hold my hand up as well now, because I was one as following Bill's diagnosis. I made sure I got my prostate checked as well. So his legacy will go on, I think, forevermore. But a lovely man, and will be greatly missed.
Yes, absolutely. Weather, what's going on? That scene behind you looks lovely. Not going to be for everyone, though.
It won't be, but there'll still be a little bit of like this over the next few days. Thank you very much, Nag. Very good morning to you as well. Not completely wet across the country this weekend, but there will be a greater chance of some rain. One or two showers around today, but in between them, a slightly more humid feel out there. We've got the showers at the moment. There have been some throughout the night across the southeast of England, a few drifting up into the Midlands, maybe southeast Wales, the odd one in eastern Scotland. The bulk of the rain, though, today will be out to the west of Scotland and some across Northern Ireland, particularly eastern areas. Some heavy, maybe thundery rain developing here. Still a few showers though across some southern parts as we go into the afternoon, but a lot of places will stay dry, and if anything, temperatures up a little bit on recent days, more widely into the 20s, peaking around 26-27 degrees with some hazy sunshine across the south. Maybe a little bit more than we saw yesterday, but still a fair bit of cloud, and even into the afternoon a few showers across the south. Heaviest probably across Wales, maybe even northwest England by this stage, and the east of Northern Ireland, western Scotland, far west of Scotland, where the rain will be that bit more persistent. And compared to what we've seen of late, breezier across parts of central and northern Scotland too. And that wind will get stronger through the night into tomorrow. Also see more in the way of heavy rain develop across western areas. Got to watch for conditions across the east of Northern Ireland, southwest Scotland. Could see some minor flooding here as we head through Saturday. Many places dry, a fairly humid start, but we'll see some showers and thunderstorms break out, not just through Saturday, but Sunday. Air of low pressure out to the west. Some pretty windy weather across some western areas too. Some eastern parts, though, will stay fairly dry throughout. I'll have more details on that later. Naga, Charlie, back to you both.
Matt, thanks very much. We'll see you later on.
17 minutes past six is the time. The search is continuing for the gunman in the fatal shooting of 9-year-old Olivia Pratt Corbell, as police released CCTV footage of the shooter fleeing the scene.
It's also been revealed that two guns were used in the attack, which took place in the Dovecot area of Liverpool 2 weeks ago. John Donison has this report.
In Liverpool, tributes continue to be laid for Olivia Pratt Corbell. It's 11 days since the 9-year-old was shot dead in the family home. And this is the man who police say killed her, using two guns and pictured on CCTV as he fled the scene.
We know this man is climbing through gardens and through people's backyards in order to avoid being identified, as well as using the roads, as you can see. Now, I know that there will be people shielding him and helping this man avoid being found by the police. If you are found doing this, then we will do everything legitimately possible to bring you to justice.
Detectives have also released footage of this man who was nearby on the night of the shooting and who they say might have important information. Police have been continuing to stand guard outside the house where Olivia died. The investigation is said to have made significant progress, but the killer, who police have described as toxic, is still at large. John Donison, BBC News.
The Conservative Party leadership race has entered its final hours. Party members have until 5 o'clock today to vote for who they want to be the next Prime Minister.
Liz Truss and Rishi Sunak will have to wait until Monday for the result. Our political correspondent Helen Catt joins us now from Westminster. Helen, it feels like it's been quite a while, to be honest, but we're right at the end now and just these closing stages, and then Monday we find out the result.
We do, yes. This contest, if you remember, started way back in July when MPs started the process of whittling down the candidates to the final two. That's then gone out to the membership for the last few weeks for them to vote on. And pretty much since the start of that phase when it went out to the membership, Liz Truss has been polling quite a long way ahead of Rishi Sunak, although if you talk to Rishi Sunak's team, they'll say he's been going down really well at the hustings, particularly we saw at the Wembley ones this week. But it is widely expected that it will be Liz Truss who is announced as the new leader on Monday. That happens around Monday lunchtime. The new leader doesn't have a very long time to get used to the idea before on Tuesday, Boris Johnson will formally resign to the Queen. The new Prime Minister will be appointed. They will have to go through all the usual things that a new Prime Minister has to do, appointing their ministers, their cabinet, getting briefings, putting all these things in place. But against the backdrop of that real time pressure of knowing they have to move swiftly to do something to help people with the cost of living, with energy bills, knowing that that rise in the typical household bill of 80% comes in October, knowing too that small businesses are already facing bills of many more times that, they will know that they will need to move swiftly to tackle that, as well as doing all the usual things the new Prime Minister would have to do.
Helen, thanks very much.
A team of United Nations inspectors has carried out a long-awaited visit to the Russian-controlled Zaporizhia nuclear power plant in southern Ukraine. The experts are to maintain a presence at the site, which was occupied by Russia soon after the invasion of Ukraine in February. The inspectors were accompanied to the plant by Russian soldiers after a risky journey delayed by shelling.
We're going to focus on the energy crisis now, and we're going to go to Blackpool. Hannah is there for us today because the Blackpool illuminations start tonight. Morning to you, Hannah. I suppose, in a way, it's one of those days, isn't it? All those lights, all the energy being used, and we all know the pressures that are on households and businesses alike.
Yeah, we've all heard that phrase, haven't we? It's like Blackpool illuminations in here, usually used to tell me to switch the lights off. But tonight out here, it really will be Blackpool illuminations. This is one of them that has been switched on early. It's a tradition that's been going since 1879, and every year it attracts millions of visitors. In fact, last year, more than 17 million people came to have a look up and down this 6-mile stretch of Prom to see what it looked like throughout the winter months. Earlier this week, I was able to get a bit of a glimpse of what it will look like. There was a ride along the Prom event where people were able to cycle along the Prom and take a look at the lights early. And I asked them how they're all feeling ahead of this winter. An evening fueled by pedal power, bringing the summer holidays to an end. The illuminations providing free fun for thousands of families as energy bills start to ramp up.
I mean, we've already spoke to the children about how Christmas might be different. You know, they might not get the big presents that they're used to, and we might do little things. It is a worrying time. You know, you think about, we've got pets at home, you know, we have a chameleon that has its tank on 24/7. You know, you think, even things like that, you're thinking, oh my goodness, that's just more pennies going down the pan.
Things that you never thought would really be an issue.
Yeah, things you'd never have to worry about.
And even as they take in the spectacle of the lights, many here fear this winter will bring much darker times.
I have a meetup. And it used to say, you know, if I put £10 on, it was going to say I had 6 days. And now it's down to 4.2. And each week it's getting less and less that my money buys. Or your electric's cut off and there's nothing you can do about it. I think it's a terrifying winter ahead for everybody.
And this 6-mile stretch of promenade is no longer paved with gold, say some businesses who've already noticed people have less cash to spend. How important are the illuminations to you?
They're very important. These are what we wait for, the illuminations, especially the weekends and especially the fireworks. They really do make a difference to our season.
Among the rush of visitors, many who want the government to set out a clearer path to bring down energy bills.
I think it's a bit ridiculous, to be honest. I think in other countries they have asked the energy companies to absorb it themselves.
The energy companies seem to make a lot of money, and we're struggling less.
It's not fair.
What do you think of them going up?
It's disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. It's not. We're happy in terms of it's not going to make a massive difference to our life, but it is ridiculous.
But for this night at least, the illuminations are providing some relief, brightening up a town where some fear they'll struggle to keep the lights on at home. Well, I'm joined now by Kate Shane from Merlin Entertainments, who run the Tower, the Sea Life Centre, Madame Tussauds here as well. Kate, how important is the switch on for Blackpool tonight?
Well, it signifies the start of the second half of our season. Most tourism destinations tend to finish at the end of the school summer holidays, but Blackpool starts again. So switch on tonight, and then it runs this year. It's obviously extended again through to the 2nd of January. So it's an extra period of time, key trading period for all of the leisure businesses in Blackpool to welcome tourists and obviously have that extra injection of cash.
We've been talking a lot about how people's budgets are stretched and all that kind of thing. Have your visitor numbers already been affected at all by the cost of living crisis?
It's difficult to say. There are so many variables. 2021 was a phenomenal year for Blackpool. The competition landscape was significantly different, no international travel, so everybody descended on Blackpool and we had lots of visitors here, record-breaking numbers. This year there aren't as many, obviously there's more competition, we've had a good year. The beauty about Blackpool, there's always something going on and lots to do with the attractions and the events.
And do the rising energy prices that are affecting a lot of businesses affect what you're doing? Are you having to make any changes as a result of them?
Well, yeah, absolutely. By very nature, we have to be agile with our businesses. We have to manage our costs within our budget and make sure that we're offering value for money experiences for the guests. But yeah, it's a challenge, obviously. Our operational expenditure is going up and we have to manage that.
And we've heard a lot about how difficult next year is going to be for businesses as well and for people as they have potentially less money to spend. Are you making plans for a kind of recession or expecting there to be less money in people's pockets, really?
We expect so. The beauty about Blackpool, it's such great value for money. We have so many free things. The illumination switch on. We've got 4 weeks of, well, 8 weeks, 4 lots of firework competitions, lots of free entertainment in Blackpool. And then obviously for the visitor attractions, we just have to make sure it's value for money and that we're not passing costs on to the customer. We're hugely mindful of the challenge people have for leisure spend. So we have discounts out there. We do promotions for people to be able to come in off-peak times and get a cheaper admission into the attractions. It's all about making sure people can come, have a great time. We still need to do that. We still got to spend time with loved ones, friends and family, but it's about making sure it's that value for money for them.
Thanks very much, Kate. And in case you're wondering, we've been told that all the electricity that's used in Blackpool Illuminations actually comes from renewable resources. They will run all the way through to January if you can't get along tonight. So plenty of time to see Blackpool lit up this winter.
Hannah, thank you.
It's coming up to 6:30. It's time to find out what's happening in terms of news, travel and weather. Wherever you are, we'll see you shortly. Good morning. You're watching Breakfast with Charlie State and Naga Monchetti.
We're this morning spending some time celebrating the life and legacy of our friend Bill Turnbull. This morning, his family has described him as bringing warmth and humour into people's homes. And for 15 years, he certainly took every opportunity to find the light amongst the dark here on Breakfast.
He's a funny man. Jane McCubbin has gone back through the archives to bring us Bill's best laugh out loud moments.
Just before the cameras went live, Bill would steady himself. And then he was ready to wake up the nation with a smile.
Wow, man, sounds like you know your way around women.
Carol, take it away with the weather, quickly. Quick.
That's the biggest laugh I've had all week.
Good. OK, you are the world's biggest flirt, aren't you?
Wow.
I just celebrated my 20th anniversary recently. Don't spoil it, sir.
Hope your wife enjoy it when you get home.
Nice.
Oh,
thank you very much.
You two are fun. I like you.
This is the route that Bill took when he went through the studio doors onto the famous red sofa in the morning, past his own smiling face. He never knew exactly what he was going to walk into when he went through those doors in the morning, but we always knew that our morning news was in safe hands.
Well, funnily enough, it looks pretty dramatic, but it's not as bad as it was before.
What have you got to moan about, mate? It's lovely.
It's cold, mate. Oh, he's back. Hold the programme, I'm having my cup of tea.
Order has been restored.
I know it hasn't, I can still hear
Harry, so you got to meet the great Bill Turnbull.
I did, yeah. Yeah, it was complete carnage. When we got the phone call, you know, would you like to come onto live TV and would you like to bring your four-year-old son? It's like, okay. I was running around the sofas and what was Bill doing? He was just trying to keep himself together whilst we were trying to have a civilised chat. What a lovely person he was, because he wouldn't have been as successful or as approachable or any of those things if he had, you know, he was just a really nice guy.
Happy with this angle, everything? Tie, hair looking good?
Pink. Because I'm happy. Club alone
if you feel like a room without. This was news with warmth and humour and heart. Bill wasn't just a presenter, he was your friend.
Oh, absolutely. I think he was a friend to everyone, and he was incredibly smart, very funny, but he wore his intellect very lightly.
So, Professor, you seem like a pretty nice chap. I hope you are here ready to rap.
Was able to sort of make anyone feel comfortable and talk to anyone about anything.
On your head, instead, Nuff said.
You can't rap, you're whack and you got no flow. Stop it, Bill, please, you're embarrassing your co-host.
Oh,
brilliant.
Lovely.
Stop.
Everyone sort of trusted Bill Turnbull, and this is how much I trusted him. I remember going around his house, we're in the kitchen, and he goes, have you got a dog? And I say, I do not have a dog. And he says, get a dog. And I say, I will not get a dog, Bill. And he said to me, a childhood for your kids is not a childhood without a dog. I didn't want a dog. Right, you ready?
Yes.
This is not my fault, this is the fault of Bill Turnbull. We're just talking about Uncle Bill.
Funny, isn't it? Funny.
Very funny. Very.
We're talking about quite a few of the things that Bill felt very strongly about, and one of those was Wickham Wanderers.
He loved them, supported them for years, even did a spot of match commentary for his beloved team. And Mike is there at the club's ground, impressive grounds, Adams Park, for us this morning. Beautiful morning there, Mike.
Yes, good morning. And so many people I've been speaking to over the last 24 hours have been speaking about their time with Bill, their favourite memories, paying tribute. This was like a second home from home for Bill, our friend, of course. He became such an integral part of this club. And yet, ironically, he admits himself that he was a bit of a glory hunter. He started supporting Wickham when he was living nearby with his family, just down the road, in the early 2000s. And Wickham got to the semi-finals of the FA Cup. And his love affair with Wickham Wanderers was started for him and his whole family, of course. And then over the years, he did become the voice of the club, commentating in his spare time for the club website. And this morning, look, they put on a special tribute on the big screen there to Bill, whose legacy is huge here. And I remember, actually, personally, one of my favourite days with Bill, away from work, was on a Saturday afternoon when he volunteered his time. He said, come along to the match against Leeds, being a Leeds fan. They were in League One at the time. And I sat alongside him in the commentary box and saw at first hand his passion and his skills. We'll be talking to one of his co-commentators in a moment. But first, let's enjoy some of Bill's highlights here over the last two decades.
This is where the real game is. You haven't got any of your fancy down millionaires.
Wickham till I die.
This is where it is.
Bill's home from home, Adams Park, the ground of Wickham Wanderers. His family became fans when they lived near here over 20 years ago, and his bond with the club grew stronger despite moving away to Salford and eventually Suffolk.
That, for me, is a yellow card.
He became the voice of Wickham, co-commentating for the club's website, never afraid to show his range of emotions.
Ooh. Oh! Whoa! And he wasn't far off.
And having a massive impact on those working alongside him.
He just attracted warmth and people would come up to him and just ask how he is and get a photo. And he's going to be so sorely missed here, but he's left a real legacy and particularly on my career and those around me, we'll be forever grateful for Bill Turnbull.
Over the years, Bill became close to the players and manager, Gareth Ainsworth, who he last spoke with just last month, and who was at the training ground when he heard the devastating news.
No, terrible. We say unexpected, and it was, because he was such a fighter and such a great character. We all knew, obviously, Bill was carrying the prostate cancer and he was fighting it unbelievably. And so with that, you all thought he's going to be around forever, Bill. So yeah, devastated, and probably the same feelings as everyone. They wish I'd have called him the day before, wish he'd have spoke to him more. But, you know, we've had some brilliant times with him here at Wickham.
Bill's influence here, his connection with the fans, the staff, the management, the players, continued right throughout his illness. Into this season, he attended the playoff final at Wembley in May, and he was a guest of the former chairman at the last home game he was able to make.
So at the end of the game, I think one of those very special moments where Gareth was walking around with the players and Blooms and Gareth saw him and they came up. And, it, you know, it's a pretty tough climb up to the boxes in terms of getting through. They went through the crowd and they came up. And again, what a special moment on that day, both for Bill, but also for the players and the people that have been in the club for a long time, to be able to just show that warmth back to Bill. And, oh, my God, yeah, not a dry eye in the house.
Really important thing about this game is...
Bill was such an integral part of this club that at one point he was even allowed to give the pre-match team talk in the dressing room. What other broadcasters can claim that?
At the end of the game, you've got to have more goals than they have, all right? What are we going to do then?
Win!
One of the players in the dressing room that day was former captain Matt Bloomfield, who now coaches and who has also now moved to Suffolk.
To the Suffolk countryside, and I'm in Felixstowe, we're about 45 minutes away, and he welcomed my wife and my two girls. We went around for lunch a couple of times, spent the day with him and his wife, and just lovely people, and made us feel so welcome, so at home, spoilt my girls, and just a real nice man. I called him about 3 weeks ago just to sort of catch up on the start of the season, and he was really pleased with how we'd started. We beat Burton and he was really chuffed about that.
There it is, and Wickham Wanderers have secured the 3 points.
For two decades then, Bill has been a fixture on match day at Adams Park. And his legacy will live on here. He'll always be part of his adopted Wickham family. Ah, oh, and someone who knows just what it's like to listen to Bill's passion sit alongside him in the commentary box is fellow commentator Phil Catchpole. Hello, Phil. Morning. Thanks for joining us. So what was he like to work alongside for you, and how did he, you know, transform your own career?
He was brilliant, Bill. He was a fan with the mic, but obviously a fantastic broadcaster and so helpful to me because we had a good deal. I would tell Bill about the football and pick him up on his mistakes that he got players' names wrong or whatever, and he would correct my grammar, things that I said wrong. He would text me and say, oh, yeah, work on this. You know, it was so brilliant for me to have someone of Bill's stature and ability to help me. I mean, I was just a fan off the terrace, and 2 months later, I'm sat here with Bill Turnbull. I couldn't believe it. Such a warm, generous guy, loved by the fans. The fans absolutely loved him because he did what they wanted to do. He got to call it, he got to have a go at the refs, he got to get excited and do all the things that commentators shouldn't do. But he got away with it because he was Bill, and he loved this club, and the fans and the club loved him.
and he helped change your whole direction of life, didn't he, your career?
Yeah, I mean, I was, like I say, I was just a fan on the terrace, ended up by accident in the press box helping out, and then I thought, well, I like this, and then I said to Bill, how do I do what you're doing? And, you know, advice along with other people as well, but, you know, I went back to college, re-qualified as a journalist. Bill, amazingly supportive of that, and again, to have him on the end of the phone and picking me up on my mistakes was absolutely fantastic for me because, you know, who else had that? It was wonderful.
And like so many people that you talk to, at first you were a bit in awe of him, but he suddenly had this passion and this way, this ability to disarm you of any worries. He was just Bill.
Yeah, the first time I saw him, I was like, wow, that's Bill, here he is. And then within seconds, he was just a mate. Yeah. And that's why fans loved him as well, because, you know, I was privileged to get to know him. And if people are watching this thinking, he seems like a really nice guy on the TV, on the radio, I can absolutely tell you, he was and more. He was a wonderful guy. So generous, so warm, and we're going to miss him hugely, absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, well, Phil, thanks very much indeed. Lovely words there. And I tell you what, when I came with Bill that Saturday to watch the Leeds game, we went to the bar afterwards, and he didn't leave the fans. He stayed there for hours. He was so involved with the club, the fans. Here's Trevor Stroud, the club director. Trevor, one of your overriding memories was in 2016 when Bill was leaving breakfast, we had a special broadcast with the red sofa here on the pitch, and you were sat on that sofa.
Yep, 10 to 7 in the morning, slightly foggy, and there was two of us and Bill on the sofa, and in true style he said, look, this is just a chat amongst friends, it's dead easy. And then with a twinkle in his eye he says, don't worry about the millions of people watching you live. And that was typical of the man.
And one of the things you loved also with his brilliant humour, his wit.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, Phil mentioned about his commentaries. I mean, they were so unbiased. Yes, but he offered constructive criticism to the referees. He called for penalties, but he was part of the fabric of the club, and he would be in the bar afterwards, and he'd just be there chatting as a fan.
Yeah,
you know, we invited him into the boardroom. He came in a few times, but generally he wanted to be a fan in the bar, and it was just a wonderful man.
And what will be his legacy? He'll never be forgotten here.
No, absolutely not. I mean, we're planning a celebration of his life for the next home game against Port Vale. It's really just everywhere. You will remember him. There'll be photos of him. He will be remembered by the club. I'm not exactly sure how. But he was part of the fabric.
I can't think of a broadcaster as a fan who's become so integral and so close to the players and the manager.
Yes, and he would host our award dinners. He just wanted to be involved with the club at any level, with the team, with the fans, anything he could do for the club, he would do it, and he will be so sorely missed.
Yeah, by us all. Trevor, thanks so much. Actually, what Trevor's saying really resonates with what we all feel, really, isn't it? I remember the first time meeting Bill, was a fantastic broadcaster, a bit in awe, but as soon as I sat on the red sofa with him, he was so supportive, encouraging. As I say, he just had this ability to make you feel at ease, to relax, like your mate. You're with your mate, Bill. Our mate, Bill.
He always used to say something cheeky, just like your guest there was saying, something cheeky just before you went on air, didn't he? Just to kind of relax the mood.
Yeah. And I think it was Susanna was saying earlier that if he started laughing, once he started laughing, it was really hard to control, wasn't it, for anybody alongside him? But it was just brilliant. Yeah, but it also fantastic, the hard news, but had that ability to switch seamlessly between the harder stories, the lighter stories, and of course, alongside him in the commentary box. What an honour that was all those years ago.
It's the only time I think Bill would have been allowed to not be to be unbiased in the commentary box, and he would have absolutely revelled in it.
Oh, absolutely, and he did give his opinions. But as Andrew was also saying, the former chairman yesterday, he'd put his arguments, but he'd also be very supportive and would listen to the other side of the coin. So if he had a problem with the referee, he'd then listen to the referee and understand their point of view afterwards. So he's understanding like that as well.
Mike, we'll be with you again throughout the morning at Wycombe Wanderers. For the moment, thanks very much.
Let's go find out what's happening with the weather with Matt this morning. Morning, Matt.
Morning, Nag. Morning, Chan. Morning as well. Bit misty and murky there in Wycombe this morning following some overnight rain. Different story, though, here in Orkney. Sunshine coming up. Lovely start, as it is across many parts of the UK at the moment. And whilst there will be some dry and sunny weather around at times this weekend, this chart screams autumn. Big air of low pressure developing to the west. Bouts of heavy and thundery rain running around it, especially across some western areas. Out there this moment, though, there is some rain around in the form of showers towards parts of the South Midlands, parts of southeast England. They're going to just work their way a little bit further northwards and westwards. Fairly hit and miss. Many places still staying dry. A bit more rain across western Scotland and developing to the east of Northern Ireland as we go through the day. And just one or two showers in eastern Scotland. A lot of you, though, having a dry day today with some sunny spells and with a southeasterly wind. Actually feeling a bit more humid out there, especially when the sun comes out. Sea temperatures more widely into the 20s, maybe turn 26 or 27 degrees towards the southeast corner. Now into this evening and overnight, after some heavy afternoon showers in Wales, maybe northern England, some of the wettest weather could be east of Northern Ireland, southwest Scotland, potential some minor flooding here, and bouts of rain pushing across Northern Ireland throughout the night. The odd shower elsewhere, many places will be dry, but compared with recent nights, especially in Scotland, Northern Ireland, it will be a much, much milder night thanks to those winds. Those winds will be picking up all the time. In fact, it'll be quite windy at times through this weekend, especially across northern and western areas. And be prepared, there will be more rain around, especially in the west, although highly variable amounts of rain mean some will stay dry. And that's the case as we start Saturday across some eastern areas. Rain will come and go across Northern Ireland, southwest Scotland, and then developing showers from southwest Scotland through northern England, north and east Midlands towards east Anglia. Those could come with the odd rumble of thunder. Either side of them, still some dry weather around, some sunshine, feeling warm in the sunshine. A windier day in the north of Scotland, but dry and sunny here. Temperatures up to around 15 to 19 degrees, maybe 25 across parts of east Anglia. But in the west, we're going to see something even windier through Saturday night into Sunday, especially across Ireland. That could cause some problems. Rain may ease off for a time, but there's more rain coming in as we go towards Sunday morning. Rain at times through Saturday night in Scotland, drier across parts of England and Wales. But it's to the west where we like to see the more relentless rain as we go through Sunday with the strongest of the winds. Quite windy across northern Scotland too. May stay dry and bright throughout this weekend in Orkney and Shetland. And not a huge amount of rain through eastern parts of England. But what all of us will notice on Sunday will be much, much more blustery. And with that, it should feel a little bit cooler. That's how it's looking. Back to you both.
Thanks, Matt. See you later on.
Time now is 12 minutes to 7. From climate change to the cost of living crisis and the war in Ukraine, Ros Atkins has been taking a look at how some of this summer's biggest news events are linked.
Let's look at how the biggest stories of the year connect. First of all, the cost of living. Because prices are going up sharply, inflation in the UK is over 10%.
Well, we've been hit by a very, very severe shock, and that shock is coming through energy prices, I'm afraid.
And the Bank of England is clear on the cause and the consequence.
You know, we've got to be blunt about this. It's coming from the actions of Russia. And I'm afraid, as you say, yes, we are forecasting a recession now.
And this impact connects to Russian gas. It's exported across Europe, but one key pipeline's currently shut for what Moscow calls maintenance. France, though, says Russia is using gas as a weapon of war. And with doubts about supply, energy prices are up. So are food prices. Ukraine's a major exporter of wheat. Wheat prices are up 25% since last year. But Russia alone isn't causing the cost of living crisis. There's climate change too.
The fundamental issue that we've got of increased frequency and increased severity of these severe weather events is a result of climate change.
At the moment, there's a drought in Europe, and droughts mean lower food production. For example, the EU's sunflower harvest is forecast to fall, which will force up the cost of cooking oil. Droughts also affect electricity production from dams. That's happening in China, which means more electricity will have to come from coal, which in turn means more emissions that cause climate change. And the war in Ukraine may affect emissions too. That's because Europe's desire to get off Russian energy may see countries increase other fossil fuel use in the short term. In the long term, though, it may drive a faster shift to renewables. And so climate change, the war, and the cost of living connect in different ways. COVID is connected too. Because as COVID restrictions ended around the world, increased demand pushed up energy and food costs. COVID also caused labour shortages, something that was exacerbated in the UK by Brexit. These labour shortages drove up costs in many ways, one being disruption of the global supply chain. Now, that's the system that allows us to produce and buy goods from far and wide. For decades, it's helped keep prices down. But when COVID put it under pressure, businesses felt the difference.
Costs are rocketing. This year, we'll see about a £6 million bill on shipping. And we're having to pass that on to our customers.
Which means more pressure on prices. And COVID's impact on the supply chain connects to another story, China's growing power. Because of all the goods made in the world, 29% come from China. And that's driven rapid economic growth and demand for more and more energy. Now, much of that energy China produces itself. Not all, though. And in June, Russia became China's top supplier of crude oil. And so China's growth, which in part rests on Western consumption, is now making it harder for the West to isolate Russia economically. There's more, too, because Chinese growth is also funding its military. These are recent drills near the self-governing island of Taiwan, which China claims as its own. America condemned these drills, as China knew it would. And so, in their very different ways, Xi Jinping and Vladimir Putin are testing the West and the limits of its global influence. If we step back, what's at stake is the world order of the 21st century, all of which and more awaits whoever becomes the UK's next prime minister.
My plan is the right plan: to tackle inflation, to compassionately support those who most need our help.
What we can't have is business as usual. We need to be bold and we need to do things differently.
And so the cost of living crisis means many people need urgent help. It also, though, connects to fundamental questions about how we organise our world and treat our planet.
Now, it's been open for 186 years, but on Saturday, the world's fifth oldest zoo, Bristol Zoo Gardens, will close its gates to the public for the final time.
And now the process to relocate its animals from lions to flamingos begins. Our reporter Jenny Kumar has been to the zoo as visitors take a last look around.
Back in Britain at the Bristol Zoo, several newcomers got a very warm and affectionate welcome from the public.
For decades, Bristol Zoo has welcomed new generations of species. Baby rhinos and rare white tiger cubs, just some of the newcomers. And generations of families have been coming here to meet them. Families like Diana's, she's been coming here for 85 years and remembers riding Wendy the elephant.
We used to climb on here and you all used to go on a ladder and she used to sway.
Why was it important for you to come today?
This has been part of my life since a very small child. And I brought my grandchildren here, and I brought my own children here. And it was always a haven, and I'm really sad it's going. But I'm glad that the animals will be freer.
Like Diana, many are making their last visits. More than 80,000 people have come in the zoo's final month. And how long have you been coming here?
Oh, since I was a baby, since I was my son's age.
Because it was closed, then we thought it'd be good for grandchildren to come and see what I saw when I was nearer their age.
In the weeks running up to the closure, it's been really busy here, with the zoo even extending its opening hours to meet demand. But it was a general fall in visitor numbers and the pandemic which led to the zoo putting this site up for sale to cover funding shortfalls. Around 70 species are moving to the zoo's more modern and larger sister site here in South Gloucestershire. But around 300 creatures are being rehomed by other zoos, like this Egyptian tortoise who's relocating to Devon. Talk us through how you're going to take him from here.
Not too exciting. He's going to get strapped into my car seat. And we've got a 2-hour journey back down to Plymouth. And we're going to go straight to the zoo, and he's got a lovely little habitat ready off show at the moment while he gets used to our surroundings at Dartmoor.
But for some of the larger creatures, it's a bit more complex.
Our flamingos we will move by shipping them all together as a flock. We'll move them in a couple of vans. We'll actually put the flamingos loose in the back with padded sides, and they move much more efficiently that way.
Another challenge the zoo's facing is the rising cost of energy, especially as some enclosures need to be kept at high temperatures.
The old sort of Victorian buildings that we have on this site thermally are not very efficient, so they cost a lot of money to heat. The new zoo will have more energy-efficient buildings, much better use of energy and sustainability built into the whole zoo.
This is me giving Wendy and then Christina the African elephant a bath.
So there are many positives about the move, but for staff it's sad to leave this special site.
I started work in January 1975, so I worked here for 45 years. And this site means everything to me. So to hear that the zoo is closing now and the grounds close in a couple of days' time is a very, very sad day, I think.
The process of moving will take several months. For now, though, the flamingos are on the move. The parrots are packing their own boxes. And some don't seem that keen to leave.
Jenny Kumar, BBC News.
Well, if it's been your home for that long...
Absolutely. When I was very young, I remember going to Bristol Zoo and writing a letter to the Duke of Edinburgh because I was concerned about the welfare of a gorilla who was kept there.
What were you worried about?
Its welfare, because it was in a cage and I thought it wasn't right. And it got a letter back.
Saying
that they would make sure that the welfare of the gorilla was, you know... This was probably in the late 60s or something. But
how
given
lovely.
That it's been going, I didn't know it'd be going for 187 years.
Well done for you for caring.
Thank you.
Time to get the news, travel and weather where you are. Good morning. Welcome to Breakfast with Charlie State and Naga Manchetti.
Celebrating the life and legacy of our friend and colleague Bill Turnbull after his death at the age of 66.
Hello, this is Breakfast with Sean Williams and Bill Turnbull.
Bill became one of the nation's most loved broadcasters, presenting Breakfast for 15 years. We'll speak to his former sofa partners later on the programme.
We'll hear how Bill's prostate cancer campaigning saved lives and encouraged thousands of men to come forward for testing.
And we'll also hear about Bill's real passions, his loves, like, for example, his football team, Wickham Wanderers. I'm here at their ground, which for two decades was like a second home from home for Bill, and where he became such good friends with the fans, the staff, the players, and the manager.
And in other news, good morning from Blackpool, which will be lit up with illuminations tonight. But with the country facing an energy crisis, I've been finding out how the town is keeping the lights on.
Plus, in weather, there'll be some dry weather around over the coming days. Some of you avoiding the rain altogether, but where we do see the rain, it'll be heavy and thundery, especially in the west. I'll have your full forecast details here on Breakfast.
It's Friday, the 2nd of September. Tributes have been coming in for our friend and colleague, Bill Temple, who's died at the age of 66.
Bill presented here on Breakfast for 15 years. It was in 2017 when he revealed he'd been diagnosed with advanced prostate cancer, and he went on to encourage other men to get themselves checked out.
Bill's being remembered by those who knew him as a wonderful friend, great fun and an incredible talent. Graham Satchell has more.
Oh, no, time code. Phil.
Bill Turnbull and Sian Williams with Thank less you. Than a minute to go before the start of another programme.
Thank you.
Oh, 15?
Bill checking everything to make sure it's perfect.
He was just great to work with. You know, you don't get up at 3:30 in the morning for 11 years to sit next to somebody you don't like, and we got on really, really well.
Hello, this is Breakfast with Sian Williams and Bill Turnbull.
The St Paul's protesters...
You know, it felt like a family. It felt like a family on set. And the Breakfast viewers felt like family to us.
Hello, good morning. This is Breakfast
with Louise Minchin
and Sian Williams.
Over the years, Bill had 14 so-called TV wives. All of them say the same things. First, that Bill was funny. Always funny.
Friday, the 27th of April.
He had a really mischievous sense of humour.
It's a sign of your immense importance that you have so many people from the studio.
Man, I don't even know what that word meant.
You need Bill as part of your entourage.
I'm not saying words like that. I don't. He ain't gonna confuse me all day.
I'll be your vocabularist.
Yeah.
Some little quirk would happen, and you'd see Bill start to laugh.
That's another one. He two for two. Vocabularist.
Yeah.
What is that? Yeah. I've never heard that mistake.
Walking thesaurus.
Oh my God! He's on fire. Bill's on fire.
And you knew that as soon as Bill started to laugh, you were not going to be able to hold it together.
Oh, he just put "is." He just put "is" on the back of everything.
Exactly. You've cracked the secret.
I am. I got nothing. I thought I had something.
You're the best guestist we've
the
had.
The guestist. Oh!
And some of my fondest moments of working with Bill were just giggling uncontrollably.
He was a brilliant, talented, insightful, sharp-eyed journalist, but at the heart of him was this really amusing, funny person that I absolutely adored working with.
We're meant to be hearing the sound
of
this.
We're hearing sound of mosquitoes, but they've decided they're going to stay in bed this morning.
I mean, the day I let the mosquitoes out, for example, I mean, what were we doing even having mosquitoes on the sofa? He let himself be bitten by the mosquitoes.
Okay.
Never let it be said
that I was tired of getting bitten by mosquitoes. Louise can punch them
stick
later.
Stick your arm in there.
Yeah.
So there you are, you know, somebody's interviewed Prime Minister, letting himself be bitten live on national television by mosquitoes. He enjoyed the versatility of being able to do everything that you threw at him.
He loved the dressing up for Children and Leaves. He loved doing Strictly. All the spangles and the fake tan, and we used to joke about it, but he just loved that. We had a lot of laughs, and I'm really going to miss that.
George Bush is walking an environmental tightrope.
Bill had a long career as a foreign correspondent. By the time he came to Breakfast TV, he was hugely experienced and extremely rigorous. He expected high standards from everyone.
He was an absolute stickler for accuracy, both in grammar and in spelling as well. And I think he called it grammar hammer.
It's to try to, not to try and.
For example, on the banned list are legendary, iconic, unique, for example.
Don't use the word iconic. Connected to anything. It's a cliche. He mentored everybody on the programme. He was like the father of BBC Breakfast.
And I am definitely a better journalist because I sat next to him with that rigour for hours and hours.
He taught me everything. He taught so many of us everything about journalism and about television and about being a decent person in this industry. He was kind and compassionate and wise and a great friend and I loved every minute of being with him, and we're really going to miss him.
When Bill was diagnosed with prostate cancer in 2018, it was a devastating blow. He was an intensely private man, but spoke out publicly, urging other men to get themselves checked.
I don't think there are many people in this world who can change lives, save lives by what they say. And he did that. And I think that is an incredible legacy. And I know there'll be people, you know, who'll be waking up tomorrow morning safe and well because of him. And that's an incredibly generous thing to have done.
Come on.
Saving other men's lives was a remarkable final act for a good man who lived an extraordinary life.
I'll remember 30 years of friendship and support and laughter. What you saw on the telly was how he was. Kind, gentle, funny, clever. Just a lovely bloke, really. And I'll miss him.
Absolutely was a lovely guy. Absolutely. Now, Louise, familiar face, you can see her there. Sat on this sofa alongside Bill for many years. Hey, Lou. It was a treat to be able to sit next to him, wasn't it?
Do you know what? It was an absolute treat, and just listening to that, it's been a kind of roller coaster of emotions. I loved working with Bill, and I loved what we've all said about him. He was just so funny. He had that mischievous, naughty, wicked sense of humour, and sometimes you'd see the glint in his eye and you go, oh no, I'm going to go. And once I'd gone, there was no stopping. I remember first when I started working with him, he said, now, there's one rule here, you must always laugh at my jokes. And sometimes they weren't funny, but I always laughed every single day. And the joy of listening to all of us talking about him and looking back over my photos those are the memories I'll take back. They're just little giggles that we would have all of the time.
And I think Sian touched upon it, Lou, that, you know, when you do get up at stupid o'clock in the morning and you come in together, you have no choice but to be a team, do you?
No, absolutely no choice at all. And, you know, he wasn't just a team for me, he was a team for the whole of the production team. I know that we all loved him so much. And you know, it wasn't to say that he wasn't sometimes tough on us, tough on me. You know, if he thought that you weren't, you know, being rigorous in your journalism, that you're using words that were on that unofficial banned list, you know, he'd always come up to you and have a kind of quiet word. But that was always done with the programme at its heart. And also, you know, I wouldn't be, as I said in that piece, I wouldn't be such a good journalist if it wasn't for him and that kind of eye for detail. And also Naga as well. You know what it's like. We wake up very early in the morning and sometimes we're dealing with really hard stories and we don't know there'll be people watching this morning and maybe they've popped out of their room and there's a child in the room watching. And he would always get the tone just spot on and perfect. And I always felt that I was in safe hands, and I know that's reflected in all the people watching today, that we were all kind of in safe hands when Bill was there on the sofa.
Morning to you, Lou. I'm just curious about the thing about working with Bill, because obviously, as another male presenter, I never actually sat alongside Bill. Sometimes on outside broadcasts when he was doing the show. But what I know and what I'm hearing from all the production team here is that thing that you touched on there, where he was tough on things when they went wrong. But that knack mm-hmm. of being kind alongside that is one that we can all learn from, because, you know, people in this industry sometimes kick off, and it happens, and we've all seen it. But from everything I hear, he had a knack somehow of making people get things right but not feel bad and make things better, which is quite a trick.
I wish that we could all do that. And you're right, I never saw him kick off. It was always done in a kind of gentle but stern way. And I think the way we appreciate that was because he was wise. He was a hugely experienced journalist. Don't forget, he'd come from a very important background of reporting. He'd been Washington correspondent. And he was, I think it was kindness and generosity with his time. I mean, even when, you know, I was still in contact with him, we're still members of a lottery syndicate, which I'm still playing, and I will go on playing, by the way. But, you know, he always was kind with his time as well. So I, for example, when I took the decision to leave BBC Breakfast, one of the first people I talked about making that decision was Bill. And, you know, he was ill at the time, but he took, you know, a time out of his day to have a long conversation with me about that. And I think we all really appreciated that, you know, he had a huge stature, a very, you know, important reputation, but he always would give back to all of us.
And on a slightly more trivial note, do you remember vividly his lycra in the velodrome?
Oh, well, you'll remember you were there on that day, Charlie. It wasn't just the Lycra in the velodrome. What I loved about him was he embraced everything, you know, whether it was interviewing the Prime Minister or being on Strictly Come Dancing or dressing up. He just absolutely embraced everybody. I remember that day very well, and I remember the key thing he said to me on that day, which genuinely changed my life, was he said, "I'm not going to be beaten by a girl on that race on the cycles." And I heard that, and I did beat him by only a millisecond. He always says to me, he still says, "Oh, if we'd gone round again, I would have beaten you." But anyway, it changed my life because, you know, suddenly I realised that I remembered I love competitive sport. So for that, I will be hugely grateful. But one thing that's been really emotional for me in the last 24 hours, and, you know, just standing here today, there is an absolutely key example. Bill was very private, actually, about his family and his lovely wife and his children, for which he was so proud. But he took that brave decision, didn't he, to talk about his diagnosis with prostate cancer, and it saved lives. And I'm standing here today with a cameraman called Bernard, who went and got checked because of what Bill said. He had an aggressive form of prostate cancer. It was caught, he had an operation, and he's here with me because of Bill. And that, for me, is a gift to everyone.
You know, Louise, and it is, every time I did an interview yesterday on 5 Live, and at the end of the interview, someone had messaged in and said, I've just booked the appointment just now. So even now, Bill is making a massive difference to everything. He was really competitive, Lou. How long did it take for him to let go that you beat him?
He never let it go.
He didn't.
He genuinely never let it go. We were always, virtually every conversation we've ever had since, he go, "But you know what? I mean, it was only because we just did one round of the velodrome. If we'd done it again, I definitely would have beaten you." And with that, we still argue about. But you know what? I loved him so much. He was such a joy to work with. And, you know, the one thing you've seen in that, on that last day when we had that huge, great big group hug, he was also, you know, just immensely sort of invested in you emotionally as well. And he was a brilliant hugger too.
He was. He absolutely was. Lou, have you let go, let go of the fact that Charlie beat us in the velodrome?
Well, that did happen. That did happen.
Nugget. So it
didn't happen.
It's just going to take one more race, Nugget. Yeah. Oh, no. I haven't. I do remember that vaguely, but, you know, I'm trying to move on.
Do you know what? I think what it shows, Lou, and it's an opportunity for us, and Bill would appreciate, is that you very rarely get to see what a team this is. And just the camaraderie we have, you know, not just the on-air presenters, the whole production team, the directors, the studio. And Bill never forgot that. He never forgot that this was a team production.
He never forgot that. And also, he never forgot as well about everybody watching today. And I know that so many of you held him in such great affection. You know, that's what he cared about. He cared about the team. He cared about the audience. He cared that we were as good as we possibly could be. And I just think, you know, that's a message we should all take forward as well in our lives, to be, you know, kind and generous and good as you can possibly be in whatever it is you do. And that was what was so brilliant about it. He just embraced everything. I mean, I remember I had a great privilege of traveling around the world with him. And we did a piece for Children in Need, Sport Relief Around the World in 80 Days. And I spent 3 weeks with him, Naga. And I remember on that first day, he said to me, "Now, Louise, just one thing." And you know when you say just one thing, you've got to listen up. He goes, "Don't use up all your conversation on the first day." And I was like, "Oh, okay." But you know what? We never ran out of things to say, because he just had so much fun in his life, and he was a great raconteur. He'd tell me hilarious stories about when he was a young man that are probably unrepeatable. But you know, he was just all the time in his whole life, he'd had great fun and made other people have fun too.
Just watching you two pillow fight says it all, really, doesn't it? Lou, thank you so much. We're watching you on that drone day. Thank you. It's been lovely reminiscing.
And thank you to Bill, and love to his family.
Yeah. Thanks, Lou.
So you get the impression this morning we're celebrating Bill's life. And I tell you, one of the things, anecdotally, what I will say is over the past few weeks and months, amazing how often people anecdotally in the street come up and say, "How's Bill doing?"
Yeah.
And I know that just recently, of course, there was a period of silence because we didn't know. And it's one of those things we just realise how much he was part of people's lives, because it's been, what, 6 years since he was here on Breakfast? And I know he's broadcasting elsewhere. But people would always routinely just stop and say, "Do you know how Bill's doing?"
Yeah,
how's getting on? It's always a marker, isn't it, of how someone makes an impact.
And you've been getting in touch with your messages. Christine, for example, emailed to say, "He was everything a presenter should be. He was a gentleman." honourable, knowledgeable and funny. Not many presenters can reach his high standards. A sad loss to the world.
This one from Cal has been in touch on Twitter. He wrote, never met Bill, but he still touched my life. He kept me company every morning as I grew up. I learned a lot about the world through his news reading. He radiated kindness even through the screen.
And all morning we've been talking about Bill's decision to share his cancer diagnosis. He was an intensely private man, but he knew that it was important. And Marsha simply says, Bill's story and documentary helped us immensely. When my husband was diagnosed, I won't ever forget that.
And that impact he had with the very, as Lou was saying, such a brave decision for a man who was very private.
Yeah.
And, you know, he didn't parade his private life for other people and then took that decision to say, I will do this thing. I'll put it out there to help other people. We will be hearing more of those stories throughout the programme this morning because that really matters.
It is 16 minutes past seven. Let's talk to Matt. Let's find out what's happening with the weather. Morning, Matt.
Morning, Agat. Morning, Charlie. Good morning to you as well. It's going to be a state of change as far as weather's concerned over the next few days. Some of you can see quite a bit of rain, some not a huge amount at all. Even today, only a few showers dotted around. Many places will stay dry and where you've got the sunshine, it will feel quite warm. Here's where the showers are at the moment. Some across southeast England, drifting northwards into the Midlands on the borders of Wales. One or two as well, very close to Aberdeenshire coast, but more in the way of significant rain out to the west of Scotland, which will develop further through the day. That sea turn wet too across parts of eastern Northern Ireland as well, and increasing chance of showers through Wales and the southwest into the afternoon. But many parts of Scotland, England, and a good part of Wales as well will stay predominantly dry through the day and pretty warm in that sunshine too. Temperatures widely into the 20s, 26, 27 for one or two in the south, but still a few showers dotted around into the end of the afternoon. Heaviest though will be across parts of Wales, maybe into northwest England, much northern England, good part of central eastern Scotland will stay dry, but there's that more persistent rain to the west of Scotland. And across Scotland, Northern Ireland, a bit more breeze developing today than we've seen of late, and that wind will develop even more this weekend. Into the tonight, we'll see rain become more extensive across some western areas. Some eastern areas will stay dry. And with winds coming in from the southeasterly direction, quite a mild night to come tonight. But as we go through the weekend, with low pressure dominating on the scene, there'll be quite a bit of rain around through western areas at times. Some windy conditions too. Further east you are, less in the way of rain. I've all details on that in half an hour. Back to you both.
Look forward to it, Matt. Thanks.
Thanks, Matt. See you then. Time now is 18 minutes past seven. The search is continuing for the gunman in the fatal shooting of 9-year-old Olivia Pratt-Corbell, as police release CCTV footage of the shooter fleeing the scene.
It's also been revealed that two guns were used in the attack, which took place in the Dovecot area of Liverpool 2 weeks ago. John Donison reports.
In Liverpool, tributes continue to be laid for Olivia Pratt-Corbell. It's 11 days since the 9-year-old was shot dead in the family home. And this is the man who police say killed her, using two guns and pictured on CCTV as he fled the scene.
We know this man is climbing through gardens and through people's backyards in order to avoid being identified, as well as using the roads, as you can see. Now, I know that there will be people shielding him and helping this man avoid being found by the police. If you're found doing this, then we will do everything legitimately possible to bring you to justice.
Detectives have also released footage of this man who was nearby on the night of the shooting and who they say might have important information. Police have been continuing to stand guard outside the house where Olivia died. The investigation is said to have made significant progress, but the killer, who police have described as toxic, is still at large. John Donison, BBC News.
The Conservative Party leadership race has entered its final hours. Party members have until 5 o'clock today to vote for who they want to be their leader and, of course, the next Prime Minister.
Liz Truss and Rishi Sunak will wait until Monday for the result. Our political correspondent Helen Catt joins us now from Westminster. Helen, morning to you. The hustings are over, these, you know, parades of their ideas. How's it looking?
Yeah, 12 hustings we've had over the last few weeks since July, when, if you remember way back then, that's when this contest started, with MPs whittling it down to the final two candidates. Since then, the final two, Rishi Sunak, Liz Truss, have been battling it out to get votes from the members. As you said, that closes this afternoon at 5 p.m. They'll be counted and the winner will be announced on Monday. Now, since it's been put out to the membership, there have been a series of polls and they have suggested that Liz Truss has consistently been quite some way in front. Although if you talk to people on Team Sunak, they'll say, well, he's gone down very well at the hustings. But it is widely expected to be Liz Truss who is going to win on Monday. The announcement comes at lunchtime on Monday. They won't have very long to get used to the idea, though, because on Tuesday, the winner will be appointed Prime Minister after Boris Johnson has formally resigned, and they will be thrown straight into that whole process of appointing ministers, setting up the government, as well as against the backdrop of that real pressure of needing to move very quickly to do something to help households and small businesses with those energy bills.
Helen, thanks very much. Helen Katner.
A team of United Nations inspectors have carried out a long-awaited visit to the Russian-controlled Zaporizhzhia nuclear power plant in southern Ukraine. Let's go to our correspondent Hugo Pechega, who's in Kyiv for us now. So, Hugo, there has been a lot of concern about fighting near the scene there. Tell us about the inspection and what's happening.
Yeah, Charlie, I think one of the goals of this visit is to create a permanent mission to monitor the activities of this station. Five inspectors remain at the Zaporizhzhia nuclear power plant. I think today the plan is for them to assess whether any damage has been caused to this facility after weeks of shelling in the area. Also, they will be monitoring the conditions under which the Ukrainian technicians are operating. We don't know yet which kind of access they had yesterday during the first day of this visit. It was a tense day. The trip was delayed because of shelling. They had to stay for hours at a checkpoint because it was too risky for them to travel. And when they were finally able to continue with their trip, they had to travel through this gray zone between Ukrainian territory and territory that has been occupied by the Russians. So it gives us a sense of how challenging it's been for this mission. Rafael Grossi, the head of the International Atomic Energy Agency, who's leading this mission, said yesterday that the team managed to visit key locations in this facility. They had gathered a lot of information, but there was still a lot of work to be done.
Hugo, thank you.
23 minutes past seven is the time. Ollie's on the sofa. Good morning.
Morning.
What's going on in the sport?
Everybody's feeling the pinch, but not the Premier League. No. It was obviously the transfer window that closed late last night.
We still talk about silly amounts.
1.9 billion across the summer.
And put that in context for us. Is that more? Is that
half a billion more? That's a record. Okay. 1.9 billion. So they've been spending big in the Premier League for the last.
It's like a 30% increase.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Good.
Got to stay in the Premier League. That's what it's all about. Good morning. Well, Chelsea spent around 270 million. That's another record. No club has spent that much before. Their final signing was only confirmed after midnight. Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang, remember him? He's back in the Premier League. Just 6 months since he left Arsenal for Barcelona on a free transfer. But with financial issues affecting the Barca club, he's been allowed to leave Spain. 33-year-old Gabon striker who left the Gunners under something of a cloud earlier in the year says he's got some unfinished business. Liverpool were another of the 14 Premier League clubs that made deadline day signings. They brought in Artur Melo on loan from Juve. He won't be available for Saturday's Merseyside derby, though, but the Brazilian will provide extra cover in midfield. They've got a number of injuries there, Liverpool. The biggest deal to go through yesterday was for another Brazilian. It's been in the pipeline for a few days, but Antony has put pen to paper on his move to Manchester United from Ajax. £82 million for him, 22-year-old winger, is reunited with his old boss, Erik ten Hag. Well, it was a good day all round for United because they also got another win under their belt in the Premier League. They beat Leicester City 1-0 at the King Power Stadium. It's three wins in a row now for them after a shaky start to the season, but the Foxes are still rooted to the bottom of the table. Joe Linsky reports.
As the total spend went up and up, there was also a match to play.
Manchester United's new-look sides had mixed results and mixed reviews. Cristiano Ronaldo set to stay, now from the bench forward against Liverpool. Since then, United have been fluid. It's the kind of recovery Leicester are desperate for. They'd not won all season, bottom of the league. It took James Maddison's second-half free kick to work David De Gea. United still have Ronaldo as an option. He's still capable of creating. But this time they didn't need a second. Leicester's best chance fell to their fullback. It's the kind of luck they're getting. There's that, like the deadline. Joe Linsky, BBC News.
To the tennis now. For the first time in the Open era, there are four British men in the third round of the US Open. Dan Evans and Cameron Norrie joining Andy Murray and Jack Draper in the last 32 in New York. Norrie's the British number one, the world number seven as well. He wasn't at his best, but he still managed to grind his way to a straight sets victory against Portugal's João Sousa. Norrie's going to play the 28th seed, Holger Rune, next. Well, Dan Evans, who's ranked 20th in New York, he beat Australia's James Duckworth. Four sets victory for him. That sets up a meeting with the 15th seed, Marin Cilic. Serena Williams has been lighting up the singles draw, but her run in the doubles with her sister Venus was very short-lived. They were playing, expected to retire after this tournament. It's back in singles action later tonight. And so is Andy Murray, so plenty of tennis to look forward to.
Oh, exciting. Very good.
Shame it's so late.
Not Andy Murray.
What time?
He's first up on Arthur Ashe, so it's going to be a sort of tea time our time.
Brilliant. Thank you for that. Thanks, Ollie.
Thanks, Ollie. Time now to get the news, travel and weather. Where you are.
Good morning. You're watching Breakfast with Charlie State and Naga Manchetti.
Time has just gone 7:30. We're spending some time on the programme saying a very fond farewell to Bill Turnbull. And really, this is a celebration, amongst many other things, of his career, of his time here on this sofa, which was 15 years. But we're also looking at things that he was passionate about.
He was a long-time Wycombe Wanderers fan. He supported the team for years. He even did some match commentary for his beloved team.
Yeah, and Mike is at the ground for us this morning, which is a very impressive ground, Mike. And there is, I saw a little earlier some of the stuff, some of the archive you dug up. Bill spent a lot of time there, behind the scenes, motivating people. He really did have a link with that place and those people.
Yeah, absolutely, Charlie. I mean, at first and foremost, he was a fan. But over the years, over the decades, he became so much more than that. And he had a real impact, as we're going to discover in the next few minutes, a real impact on the board, the directors, the players and the manager. He became such good friends with them, an influence. He even gave a team talk on one special occasion as he celebrated, I think it was 15 years at the time, being a fan. But it all started, bizarrely, he says himself, being a glory hunter. 2001, he was living locally and Wycombe got to the semi-finals of the FA Cup and his love affair with this club started. And actually down here on the pitch side, you can appreciate as well why he fell in love with this unique club nestling on the edge of Wycombe, right in the heart of the Chilterns, with all that amazing scenery behind. But it wasn't about the scenery for Bill, of course. It was about the football. I was here with him back in 2009 for a Leeds game when they were in League One playing Wycombe, and I sat alongside him in the commentary box. It was a Saturday afternoon. Both had some time away from the red sofa. It was a real special occasion, an honour to witness his commentary skills. For once, he could be passionate and unbiased. He could give his own opinions on what he thought of the referee. We'll see a little bit of that now. Before I speak to our longtime captain, Matt Bloomfield, as well, about his thoughts and friendship with Bill, let's enjoy some of his highlights here over the last two decades.
This is where the real game is. You haven't got any of your fancy damn millionaires.
Wycombe till I die.
This is where it is.
Bill's home from home, Adams Park, the ground of Wycombe Wanderers. His family became fans when they lived near here over 20 years ago, and his bond with the club grew stronger despite moving away to Salford and eventually Suffolk.
That, for me, is a yellow card.
He became the voice of Wycombe, co-commentating for the club's website, never afraid to show his range of emotions.
Ooh. Oh! Whoa! And he wasn't far off.
And having a massive impact on those working alongside him.
He just attracted warmth and people would come up to him and just ask how he is and get a photo. And he's going to be so sorely missed here, but he's left a real legacy and particularly on my career and those around me will be forever grateful for Bill Turnbull.
Over the years, Bill became close to the players and manager, Gareth Ainsworth, who he last spoke with just last month. And it was at the training ground when he heard the devastating news.
No, terrible. We say unexpected, and it was, because he was such a fighter and such a great character. We all knew, obviously, Bill was carrying the prostate cancer and he was fighting it unbelievably. And so with that, you all thought he's going to be around forever, Bill. So yeah, devastated, and probably the same feelings as everyone that wish I'd have called him the day before, wish you'd have spoke to him more. But, you know, we have had some brilliant times with him here at Wycombe.
Bill's influence here, his connection with the fans, the staff, the management, the players, continued right throughout his illness. Into this season, he attended the playoff final at Wembley in May, and he was a guest of the former chairman at the last home game he was able to make.
So at the end of the game, I think one of those very special moments where Gareth was walking around with the players and Blooms and Gareth saw him and they came up. And, it's a pretty tough climb up to the boxes in terms of getting through. They went through the crowd and they came up. And again, what a special moment on that day, both for Bill, but also for the players and the people that have been in the club for a long time, to be able to just show that warmth back to Bill. And, oh, my God, yeah, not a dry eye in the house.
Really important thing about this game is
Bill was such an integral part of this club that at one point he was even allowed to give the pre-match team talk in the dressing room. What other broadcasters can claim that?
At the end of the game, you've got to have more goals than they have, all right? What are we going to do then? Win!
One of the players in the dressing room that day was former captain Matt Bloomfield, who now coaches and who has also now moved to Suffolk.
Tied to the Suffolk countryside, and I'm in Felixstowe, we're about 45 minutes away, and he welcomed my wife and my two girls. We went round for lunch a couple of times, spent the day with him and his wife, and just lovely people, and made us feel so welcome, so at home, spoilt my girls, and just a real nice man. I called him about 3 weeks ago just to sort of catch up on the start of the season, and he was really pleased with how we'd started. We beat Burton and he was really chuffed about that.
There it is, and Wycombe Wanderers have secured the 3 points.
For two decades then, Bill has been a fixture on match day at Adams Park, and his legacy will live on here. He'll always be part of his adopted Wycombe family.
Well, let's talk to the former captain, long-time captain, now coach, of course, Matt Bloomfield. Hi, Matt. Thanks morning. For your time this morning. So when did you first become aware of Bill and his impact on the club? And how was it that he got so close to the players, which is quite unusual for a broadcaster?
Yeah, I suppose the first interaction we really had was in 2008 when I did my ACL on my knee reconstruction. And during when I was injured, I did some commentary with Bill up the top. And that was when we first kind of, you know, had a bit of contact. He made me feel so comfortable. He's obviously an expert in his field, and that inspired me to do a sports media degree as well off the back of that. So we kind of became friends off the back of that. It's obviously 14 years ago. So,
wow.
Yeah, he's an incredible man. And like I say, his inspiration from being such an expert in his field led me to do a sports media degree, and our sort of friendship kind of grew from there.
And we saw the team talk there, one of the highlights, and that was fun to be part of.
Yeah, I'd actually forgotten about that till I saw the footage again yesterday. He took the team talk, and then obviously he was there for our greatest ever moment at Wembley in 2020, you know.
The playoff final against Oxford, when you reached the championship.
Yeah, for the first time, I think 133-year history, we made the made the championship, and he was there. Officially, he was a journalist, but unofficially, he was a one-man support act. You know, I think if you watch the footage back, you can just hear him the whole game, singing songs and getting, you know, creating some atmosphere for us. At the end of the game, I was full of emotion. I went to the side of the pitch, and he was there, gave me a massive hug, and it was just a really special moment. You know, little did I realise that I'd be sort of reminiscing back on that moment so soon.
Yeah.
But 2 years on, you know, those kind of memories will live forever for me.
Yeah, I think he was chanting Chairboys, the club's nickname all the way through, wasn't he?
He was, yeah. He was a one-man Chairboys Barmy Army, he really was. And like I say, that was it for us, you know. He inspired the players. He led a team development day last year. He was a friend of the club, a supporter of the club, and an inspiration for not me, but the players and all the staff and many supporters as well.
Yeah. Why was he so motivational, do you think, for the players and the team?
I think he just had this aura about him. You know, you obviously recognised you know, his face and his voice from the morning television. And then when he came in, he was just so humble. He had a quick wit about him, and he just, you know, made you feel comfortable in his company. And the lads just drew to him and just were warm to him straight away. So he did that, and he was able to inspire people, you know. And over the last 5 years, he inspired us with his brave battle against his illness. You know, he never showed any pain. He was always upbeat whenever you spoke to him and saw him. I spoke to him a few weeks ago and he's still upbeat then. It's just, you know, how he can live his life like that and be an inspiration to everyone. He had me and my wife and my girls around his for lunch a couple of times, him and his wife. We were supposed to go around this summer, but unfortunately we weren't able to go because of his illness. But I wish we had been able to see him one last time, but we'll you know, take the memories.
Yeah, well, Matt, thanks very much indeed for your lovely words. Echoes what we all feel, really, and the impact here, the legacy that Bill has had on Wycombe Wanderers will never be forgotten.
Mike, it's very, very moving, I have to say. And I know you've been there a lot. I feel like I'm learning enormous amounts today, and all the players and all the people you're talking to there, very moving this morning.
Yeah, and it really echoes and resonates what we say about working with Bill and as a friend on the breakfast sofa. It was exactly the same here, just in a different role in his spare time, as a fan, whether it be with the players, like Matt, with the manager, or in the bar afterwards with the fan. He just put everyone around him at ease. Bill, their mate.
Yeah, enjoying it. Thank you very much, Mike. So the idea this morning is that we're giving you a sense of some of the things. Maybe you didn't know. I feel like I'm being quite a learning curve there about Bill and High Wycombe. There are other parts of his life which people knew a bit more about.
He was intensely private, actually, and we've spoken about it, and we will continue to, about him revealing his prostate cancer diagnosis. And just had an email regarding that. He just titled Bill from someone who says, prostate check today at 11 o'clock. Thanks, Bill.
Well, look at that. That's amazing,
isn't it? That's one of the legacies.
And it's worth saying, we are able to smile a lot this morning because there's so many good things. We can do more of that in a minute. But all of our thoughts, of course, are with Bill's family this morning. What must be a very, very difficult time for them. But we've had contact with them here on the programme. And I know that what they've said as family is that the contact that they've had with people, hearing people talk about Bill, the impact he's had, is making a huge difference to them. So this programme is very much about them as well.
In 2005, Bill took part in the third series of Strictly Come Dancing. His partner was Karen Hardy.
So together, the pair made it all the way to week 7. That is despite Bill injuring his ankle. We can look back now at some of those highlights.
First, welcome Ballroom Bill, as he's now called in the newsroom. Beautiful morning.
Oh, what a beautiful So long as it doesn't come too humiliating, I think I'll maintain some kind of journalistic credibility.
We're like the married couple.
Go, Stud Muffin!
I have an innate resistance to being told what to do.
You're going quite fast, but never mind.
Oh, dear. That's a mistake.
How much do you charge your students to tell them the wrong step?
Heaven.
Relentless quick-step training to go. Bill suffers a disastrous injury.
I'm dancing, and I'm not going to let Karen down.
I don't need no TV. I don't need no news.
It's Bill and Karen.
You've given me the experience of a lifetime.
Oh, sweetheart.
And I thank you very much.
Tonight will not be the last night. We've got a whole lifetime together.
I would not swap Bill for anybody. He really is my hero. Inside, he's so sweet and cuddly. Hold me in your
arms tonight. I came off the dance floor and she burst into tears. I can be your hero,
baby. Karen's with us now. Karen, how are you doing?
Well, I've had better days, I'm not going to lie. What can I say? I've had a heartbreaking moment when the news was shared with me. As I think you all know, I'm over here in New Zealand, so I got the news yesterday. But the big thing for me today is to really be here to celebrate and to celebrate what it's all about. And I've learned that to stop the tears, I got to keep squeezing my finger and thumb here. But I just hearing all those great memories there, this man was just a legend. And you know, back then, what are we now, 2022, we were the third year of doing Strictly Come Dancing, and I think at one moment Bill was going, wow, I don't know why I'm here, but you know what, I am going to learn to dance. And I got to meet with this most incredible man. This man that he had no idea what I was going through. I had long retired from dancing. I just had a baby. My son was just, I think, about 6 months old. And I remember our meeting. It was all very, very secretive. And we drove out into the countryside somewhere. Beautiful house. And I was stood outside, and the camera was all ready for us to meet. And from nowhere, these words were, could we get this damn thing over and done with? I've got to get on. And I just remember this bellowing voice, and I'm going, does he even know who I am? Does he know what I've given up to be here? But that was the magic that was between us, because I got to know who he was about 30 seconds later. He got to know who I was, and we went down the most incredible pathway. My stud muffin. Yes, I don't know where that word came from. I called him a stud muffin.
He'd have loved that.
He did. He absolutely loved it, and it stood by him. But, you know, that show, what's magical about Strictly Come Dancing is you get to know the real people. And as you guys know there, time and time again, I got to see a side of this gentleman. It has to be a gentleman that would be stood there. I remember we were stood doing the cha-cha-cha at one point, and he was relating it to a moment when he was down behind a tank. I think it was in the Iraq war, and I would look at him with the utmost admiration, going, the knowledge that this man has, the strength that this man has, the way he could laugh at himself, the way he could connect with anybody. And you know, he wasn't just going to come on the show just to have a bit of fun. He was on there to really learn to dance. And I just remember him saying to me, you know, where does this dance come from? And what's it about? And what's the count? And just so many good memories. And I know in the mornings, it was very new for me to come on to BBC Breakfast because we started talking about top lines and contra checks. And he's going, the public don't have a clue what you're talking about. We need you on air. We need you to be explaining a little bit. So I used to come and sit on the couch, and sometimes he wasn't there, but I knew he'd ring me straight away afterwards going, I've watched it back. You need to sit up a little bit more. You need to express yourself, and too many teeth. Get those words out and connect good knowledge to people. You know, that was the magic about him. And one word that he taught me that I will never forget, I used to say authoritative, and he taught me it was authoritative, Karen. It's authoritative. And I've never been able to say that word since without getting a flash from him, which has been just very magical. I did want to share, I don't know if I know time is short, but one of my last texts with him, he goes, amazing how after 16 years, people still ask me about Strictly. Some of the best fun I ever had. I'm always grateful to you for that. And I just...
Karen, you know, the bonds that were created and the friendship you had, it was precious. And I can't, honestly, I know it's so upsetting, but you've done him proud. You've done it eloquently, you've done it elegantly, and you've painted a picture of a man that we all loved, and you've absolutely done him proud. So
I'll tell
well
you the
done.
Other thing, Karen, as well. It's so lovely hearing your reminiscences there. What it does, and maybe, you know, I know you're a long way away, but the pictures we've been broadcasting this morning, the two of you dancing, I have no doubt they will have made a lot of people smile this morning, because it was just fun. It was fun.
Yes.
Thank you,
it
Karen.
Was. And I thank him for really being a big part of where Strictly is today. He brought that family entertainment, had the most incredible family that he was forever talking about.
Yeah.
And some of the funny things he shared with me. Absolute gentleman, and we're celebrating him, which is magical.
Exactly right. Lovely to speak to you. Thank you so much for your
Take
time.
Take care. There are firm friendships made on this programme, as you can imagine. Carol and Bill, or Billy, as she calls him, is just one example of that.
Yeah, they go back a long way. So Carol joined Breakfast the year before Bill, actually, so they knew each other really well. Here are some of her memories.
I loved working with Bill because he was so naughty. He had that little twinkle and sparkle in his eye, and you didn't always know what you were going to get.
I was taking great interest in your isobars there. Would you say they were tightly packed?
They are quite tightly packed, yes. Yeah. Sometimes he would deliver something so off the wall it would completely throw you, but it would make you laugh because it was meant in good humour and with good spirit.
Well, they did think of asking Carol to be the next Doctor Who. She says she's too busy going to lovely places like Highgrove.
Morning.
Good morning. I think it could be his mum, and as he's a Time Lord, that's saying something, Billy. I remember one time I was in the Blue Peter Garden and I was doing an experiment with measuring jugs. And he threw to me with, he always called me Kirky, and he said, Kirky, are you going to do your experiment again in the programme? And I said, yes, I'll have my jugs out in 15 minutes. And his face was going bright red from trying not to laugh, and then he just erupted. And that was Billy. He was fun.
Carol's wide awake this morning, so she can get my name right this time around. Hello, Carol.
Good morning, Charlie and Billy and Louise. Joking only. And just adored working with him. When I saw he was on in the morning, my day was already complete before we'd even started. Moving across Scotland. Oops, my necklace has just fallen off. I'm rain. It's hard.
How many years? It's never happened. It's never happened. How many years? It's never happened. You're dangling a bit there, aren't you?
Oh, my goodness. I'm so sorry about that. Yes, I could just feel it coming off and slipping further and further side. Well, and I learned screeds from him as well. And he was a wonderful, loyal, kind friend. And I'm going to miss him terribly. What a loss. What an absolute loss. So have a fabulous day. Whatever you're doing.
Since we safely reached the end of the programme,
You can have your mistletoe back.
Does that mean I can get in there? Happy Christmas, Billy.
He grimaced, but I know he loved it, really.
Also, that thing of embracing things when they go wrong.
Yes,
that's it. That's a good turn. So let's turn our attention away for a moment. 7:51, we're going to be talking about the energy crisis now.
Yeah, the big switch on for Blackpool Illuminations is tonight. But of course, lots of things we've been talking about is how to keep the lights on. So Hannah's taking a look this morning. You're at Blackpool Tower. Morning, Hannah.
Morning. Yes, this is one of the illuminations that's been switched on early. We've actually just counted, and there are more than 80 light bulbs on this installation alone. We're told the illuminations are powered by renewable electricity that comes from renewable resources. That, of course, is very topical at a time when rising gas prices are causing the cost of living crisis. The illuminations are a tradition that's been going since 1879, stretching for 6 miles up and down this prom, attracting millions of visitors every year, trying to bring in business and keep the town cheerful through the winter. So when there was a chance to go earlier this week to catch a glimpse of what this year's illuminations are going to be like, I went along and asked people how they're feeling about the winter ahead. An evening fuelled by pedal power, bringing the summer holidays to an end. The illuminations providing free fun for thousands of families as energy bills start to ramp up.
I mean, we've already spoke to the children about how Christmas might be different.